Hello, everyone. My name is Alex, and I'd like to welcome you to this month's Astronomy on Tap. Thanks so much for joining us. If you've never tuned in before, I am, again, Alex, a grad student from University of Santa Cruz, of California, Santa Cruz, and we host this event every month to sort of introduce the public to some really cool projects and ideas that professional astronomers and researchers and academics are engaging with and studying, and they're just doing all sorts of cool stuff. So we're really excited to be sharing this with you all this evening. I hope that everyone had a really great holiday and transition into the new year. You might notice that I got this painting. I got it just for Astronomy on Tap, just for you all. But hopefully one day you all can stop seeing me in this setting, and we can go back to in person having a nice beer in Santa Cruz. So yes, let's hope for that transition soon. So today we've got two really awesome speakers, both astronomers from the astronomy department on Santa Cruz's campus. And they're here to talk to you about the instruments that we use to look at and study the cosmos. So really exciting things from them this evening. There will be Q&A after each of the speakers, and there will also be a trivia portion during the sort of intermission in between the two speakers. So make sure that you've brushed up on your astronomy trivia so that you can win my accolades at the end of the stream. We'll call out your name and all that sort of stuff. So yeah. Okay, well, I think that's all I've got for the introduction. Make sure that, you know, you're putting any questions or anything like that into the chat beneath the YouTube video, and we'll try to interact with you and things like that as the show goes on. So yeah, sit back, relax, pour yourself something to drink, and let's jump in. So first, the first speaker I want to introduce is Becky Jensen Klim. Here to speak with us this evening. So hop on. Oh, just kidding. I'm so sorry. Wrong order. Our first speaker is actually Phil Hinz. So Phil, jump on in.
All right. Thanks, Alex.
Yeah.
I'm really glad you putting this on. Let me get my slides up.
Yeah. Thank you for joining us this evening. Have you done an Astronomy on Tap presentation before?
I've never done an Astronomy on Tap presentation, virtual or otherwise, so this will be new for me.
Awesome. Well, welcome. We're happy to have you, and I'll let you have the floor.
All right. Thank you. So it's really, really great to be able to talk to you tonight, and appreciate the organizers for setting this up and for all the work to get us together. As Alex says, it's too bad it's virtual. I'm here with my beer, wishing I could, you know, share it with some of you around the Zoom room, but one day soon. Today, Becky and I are going to split the topic of photographing faraway worlds, where we're going to be talking about mainly the technology. Becky will get into a little bit more of the science side of things. I'm going to stay on the technology side pretty exclusively. And it's an area that I spend a lot of my time thinking about. I run the lab for adaptive optics at UCSC. It was started by Clara Max and others at UCSC. It's been running for several decades now, creating a lot of new technology that I'll talk about today. All right, so I want to start by taking a little bit of a nostalgic trip down thinking about exoplanets. When I was growing up, the movie that I first, you know, piqued my interest was one of the first movies I saw in theater, Empire Strikes Back, where, you know, already they're going to see through, they're going to see planets, you know, exploring it, seeing worlds that are very different than our own. I'm going to just stop for a second and reshare with the screen with my sound on. So you want just hearing me? I think I made a... Sorry, technical difficulties. Can you tell I haven't done this before? Give me just a second and I will. Reshare. All right, so sorry about that. I'm gonna try this again. All right, so, you know, back in the 80s, there's already plenty of movies out, well before that as well, talking about other worlds.
No, I'm not going to change my mind about this. I'm not picking up any cities or technology. Massive life form readings, though. There's something alive down there.
Right, maybe life on the planet.
I'm sure it's perfectly safe for droids.
And they get to explore it in their X-Wing, right? I mean, it's something... That it really is a lot of us an area for where we picked up inspiration for what is out there in the universe. Another big one for me, Star Trek. For me, it was the Next Generation, right? So, you know, the opening is something that still sort of gives me chills. The idea of exploring space. Of course, it's not just stars and the galaxies, it's the worlds, right? It's what they see, new worlds. All right, so I want to subject you to the whole
space
entry,
the final frontier.
Introduction, but
these are the voyages of the Starship Enterprise.
It's worth thinking about, you know, what did we know about planets back then? And the answer many of you may know is almost nothing, right? It was, we did not know that planets existed around other stars. Astronomers were working hard, certainly, to understand that. But it wasn't until 1995 that the first planets were detected in an indirect way. And much later, another decade or so, before we were actually able to form pictures of planets. So I want to tell part of that story today, which is how can we see planets directly? What's the technology needed in order to do that? And the problem is, if you're looking at a bright object in the sky, you can think of that light that your eye sees as waves coming down on you, some of those waves making it into your eye, and your eye forms a nice sharp image of that thing you're looking at. But the problem is the last few tens of kilometers that light travels. Most of the way it travels, it forms these nice circular waves which spread out. But the last little bit, it hits the atmosphere, and the atmosphere is not perfectly uniform. And so some of the light speeds up, or not, it goes as fast as it had previously. Some of it gets delayed a little bit. And so you get a deformation, a distortion to the wavefront that affects our ability to see it. Now, you can't really, that's not the most obvious effect, but out of the telescope, what you see at very high magnification is a blur of light rather than a very sharp image. That's what this movie is showing at the beginning. And so when I say I work on adaptive optics, what I mean is a technique to fix this. And it's a technique to take out the distortions of the atmosphere. And so if you have a system that's properly designed, you go from something that looks like that to something like that. And you can see that now, instead of a single object, we can tell that the object we were looking at has a fainter companion to it. It's another star in this case, not particularly dimmer, but so one of the key technologies to seeing other planets is forming sharper images. But sharper images actually helps you out in another way. It allows you to see the image if they're close, if those two are close together. But it also allows you to see fainter things. So this is the adaptive optic system turning on in another system for looking at another scene. And you know, we can see objects next to one another, but it's also more obvious that there's a fainter companion further away. And that was separate. It wasn't all blurred together originally. But it was very faint before you were able to concentrate the light by forming these sharp images. So that's it in a nutshell. Adaptive optics helps you form sharper images. It helps you see fainter than you would be able to see without it. All right, so how does that work? Well, I talked about those distorted wavefronts coming from the source. You can think of them as sort of successions of, you know, wrinkled paper coming in to your optical system. And if you can have an optic that deforms in the exact opposite way to those distorted wavefronts, you can create a perfectly flat wavefront. Form an image of that, you can form a very sharp point-like image from that corrected wavefront. So the adaptive mirror or deformable mirror is one element of an adaptive optic system. But the other key part is, how do you measure what the distortions are for the wavefront? And so that's a piece of technology called a wavefront sensor. And then you need to be able to, from those measurements, tell the adaptive mirror what to do. And that has to happen something like 1,000 times a second. So very fast. And that's something that's technologically very challenging. But if you can do it, let me tell you a few things that you can give you a few examples of how that improves the astronomy. The left image here is Keck without a telescope, without adaptive optics. This is a 10 meter size telescope. So it's a very a big telescope, our largest diameter in use right now. But that image that you're seeing on the left is no sharper than you could see with a backyard telescope that amateur astronomers use, you know, maybe 8 inches across. You take that to a good high mountaintop site, you can form the same sharpness image. That's because of the turbulence that's messing this up. If we can take an image with a space telescope, so this is HST image at the same wavelength. So now we can see bands across Neptune. But of course, with adaptive optics and a even larger telescope, we can get to even sharper images. So that's the promise of AO. And so, you know, planetary astronomers use this for tracking storms, understanding circulation patterns, getting detailed composition measurements of these atmospheres of planets in our own solar system already, which is sort of a preview of some of what we want to do with planets around other stars. Give you another science area. The galactic center is a very interesting area to image because we think there's a black hole at the center. We've suspected this for quite some time. And by using adaptive optics, you can see with much more clarity what the set of stars are around that central dark mass, right? And so that's interesting already, just understanding what exists at the very center of our galaxy with as high a angular resolution as we can get. But the real key, and this is something that is something that has been very exciting to watch recently get it recognition, real key is to watch it over many years. So this is a plot of the stars in the galactic center. They're labeled different S0 numbers and how they move over time. So we're looking at 1995 epoch right now. This is a group led by Andrea Ghez at UCLA. And she followed it for years, very patiently watching these stars in 2008, go around the galaxy. Some of them form closed orbits. So you can see it go very close to the central dark mass. And from that, you can measure the mass. And so there was Andrea Ghez's group in UCLA and a group in Europe who were jointly awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics for this ability to constrain the massive, supermassive black hole at the center of our galaxy. But the one of the key technologies was large telescopes combined with adaptive optics to be able to form these very sharp images. All right, enough about other people's science. I want to talk to you about what we like to use adaptive optics for. My group and I and Becky and a large part of the astronomical community, which is to see a planet. And so if we go back to that seeing limited, that limited by the atmospheric turbulence image, we expect the planets to be somewhere right in here, you know, several tenths of an arc second away, several tens of thousands to 100,000 times fainter. And so the first step, as I said, is to form an image with adaptive optics. You get a much sharper image. And I'm showing an image that's stretched quite a bit so we can see the faint structure. And so you can see some rings, which are just imaging artifacts. What we're looking at is just the central star. So how do you get rid of that central star so that you can see the much fainter objects around it? Well, now instead of a constantly varying image, we have something that's quite stable. And that stability is something we can use. We can take the first image we take and then subtract it from the next image and the next image. And we can follow it for a long period of time over the night. And so that's what the next image is going to be, next video is going to show. It's going to show the images we took over time with the first image, or an approximation, the average image subtracted. And then as we watched it with a telescope over time, this is over an hour or two, the scene rotates. You can think of this as, I don't know if you've ever paid attention to this, if you ever watch the moon rise and then go across the sky and then set on the other side, you know, the side that comes up first, if you look at that side sometime later, as it's sort of halfway through the sky, it's on the right. If you look at it as it's setting, it's the bottom. Right? In other words, that whole moon image rotates as you're watching it over time. And we make use of that. We can actually say, okay, anything we see around this star has to be rotating at a speed that we know about, because that's just the scene rotating, the sky rotating. So from this, you should be able to actually see with your eye a planet or two or three or four in there. So my question to you is, how many planets do you see? You can put it in the questions in the chat if you like, and see whether we get any consensus. Play it one more time. Your eye's actually pretty good at figuring out what's a glint, something like this, which doesn't really move, and something like this, which is pretty obviously moving constantly around the star clockwise. And once you know everything's going clockwise, you can say, oh, maybe there's a second one right here that's going clockwise. In fact, it's a little bit easier if I sort of drag it back and forth. I don't know whether. All right, so is there any consensus on how many stars or how many planets you can see in this video?
I'm chiming in to bring information from the chat on YouTube. It looks like 4 to 5, 4, another guess of 4.
All right.
How are they doing?
So 4 is good. Let me show you, I'll try and point. This one's very faint, but we'll rotate and you can see it. And these two were what the previous ones I pointed out. The one that's really hard to see, but is there, is this one right in here.
Oh, wow.
But it is there and it's detectable. That is, I mean, we decided that was a real detection. And if you said 5, you're just like many other astronomers who start seeing things in the noise. Trying to decide whether it's real or not. And you know, there's been It's a really hard problem to actually say where your limit is of being able to detect something. Mm-hmm. Here's the final image. That's what we can do with taking that full image and actually making it into one final image. You can see that there's, and in some sense, these dark streaks are part of that process of how you actually see whether there's something there that goes at the right rotation rate. Mm-hmm. Anyways, Becky will talk a little bit more about this because there's more tricks than the one I showed. The one I showed was sort of the first one astronomers thought of, and there's been more since. Okay. Let me finish by talking about the technology a little bit more, which is we would like to do that on our current level of telescopes, 8 to 10 meter class telescopes, and use the same techniques on the next generation of telescopes. So UC is part of a large international project called the 30 meter telescope, where it's three times as large, so 10 times as much collecting area. So we can see things that are much fainter, but maybe more importantly, we can form even sharper images. It's not just the turbulence that limits our sharpness, it's the size of the telescope. All right, so I just want to show you some enabling technologies that we're testing out. That they are along the lines of what I've shown you already. There's wavefront sensors. We want to be able to operate these more precisely. There's larger deformable mirrors that we can use, which can be essentially one of the telescope optics. And that gives you higher efficiency and better sensitivity. And then some of those images I was showing you were taken with infrared detectors, where we're still trying to improve what wavelength they can cover and how sensitive they are. It's always hard to show off technology as it's being developed because you're spending a lot of time in lab basically just measuring how well it's doing. And so the best way I can think of is it's sort of like showing baby pictures. I'm going to show stuff that I'm really proud of that we've been working on the past couple of years. And I hope that you don't, if you aren't impressed by it, that you can at least say, wow, have some good compliment about it. So one of them is a wavefront sensor. And we have to create these very precise optics to divide up the light. And so it turns out one of the best ways to divide up the light is to form an image of a star on the tip of a three-faceted pyramid. And these are made to optical quality. These pyramids are made to optical quality. So a third of the light is split in each direction. And the relative amount of light that you then measure is an indication of how your wavefront has been distorted. So you take that information and drive your deformable mirrors. This is a project by a graduate student, Dominic Sanchez, who's made a lot of good progress on this recently. So that'll actually go up to Lick Observatory soon on one of the telescopes there. We're working on larger deformable mirrors. Right now, most deformable mirrors are sort of, the size of your hand. And what we would like to do is make them the size of a telescope mirror, which can be, if it's a secondary mirror, can be, a third of a meter to a meter in size. And so we're testing out the ability to make thin glass shells to the precision we need. And then they get pushed on by many small actuators. You can think of them as sort of speaker coils, the same technology of running a current through a wire and pushing and pulling on a permanent magnet. Is what drives these mirrors. And so this animation in the lower right shows us just pushing and pulling on this particular mirror. This is a project by a graduate student, Rachel Bonds Rubin. And you can see that it's very close in the outcome to what the data we actually measure. We're measuring it with a device called an interferometer on the left here. All right, and then the final bit of technology I'll talk about is that we're testing out sensitive infrared detectors that you can think of as measuring the heat from objects. We give off heat, but really it's infrared light. It's light that's longer wavelength than our eyes can detect. There's a great demo of that if you go to the exploratorium. This was pre-pandemic when my family and I went to the exploratorium and So this is, they're all looking at, you know, how they look according to an infrared sensitive detector. You know, my son's figured out that, you know, if he puts his arm up, that the warm part that's been heated by his leg is warmer. You can see this portion of the clothing is darker because it's cooler than the part that's right next to his arm right here, things like that. Oh, other weird things like glass turns out to be opaque in the infrared. So you can't use regular glass for your optics. If you use this, you have to use more exotic stuff. Brittany Miles is working on this, and she's holding one of our infrared detectors that we're in the middle of testing. To do so, she needs to put it into a cryostat that keeps everything very cold. We use liquid air of different sorts, liquid nitrogen if we're just trying to do something quick, liquid helium if we need to get it even colder, then liquid nitrogen will go. All right, so there's your whirlwind tour through some of the technology. I hope you have an appreciation for, over the past 25 years, how we've gone from almost no knowledge of where the planets around other stars exist to being able to sort of gather and appreciate those images. They're still points of light, but they're starting to tell us something very interesting about planets around other stars. That picture I happened to show you was four Jupiter-like planets around a particular star that is, each of them were about 8 times as massive as Jupiter. So a much different system than what we have around our own. And of course, you know, where I tend to spend a lot of my time is thinking about the technological breakthroughs that are needed to study these. All right, thanks for listening.
Nice, thank you so much. That was a really awesome talk. Okay, there have been a few questions coming in from online. So I'll start with our first from Robert, who's asking, is there a hard limit to AO wavefront correction as atmospheric turbulence degrades, or does quality of the output degrade more gracefully?
I'm not sure let me try and answer to that question, but I hope I get the sense of the question right. So it's still important with adaptive optics to have a very good atmospheric sight. So in other words, you don't get around the turbulence, you just improve it, and you improve it up to some limit. So there are limits. It's typically how finely you space your actuators on your deformable mirror. And so the more precisely you want to correct it, the more actuators you need. And then, you know, you can't make these devices with an infinite number of actuators. So that trade-off of how many you can make before you run out of money to buy a deformable mirror with enough actuators is sort of what drives the state of the art. It's about one of the best devices for this is the Gemini Planet Imager, and it has, I believe, a 4K, 4,000 actuator mirror.
Oh, wow. How many actuators does the mirror have on Keck? Or on,
So the Keck is much less. So it's about 400.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And so it's good for high precision, it's forming good quality images, but not, it doesn't then get to as deep as you might get with some of the other really, they're called extreme AO, really pushing the limit.
Extreme. Yeah. Cool. Okay. Next question from Rebecca. Let's see, per hour, maybe the cost per hour for this sort of thing, how much research funding is required? And I said, when do I get to take it home?
I mean, the devices we're talking about are quite expensive. So, you know, typically the deformable mirrors are hundreds of thousands, into the millions for some of the really state-of-the-art ones. And the cameras that I'm talking about are sort of similar level. So the way these are funded by consortiums of astronomers that you know, band together to convince, you know, different funding agencies, typically NASA or the NSF, that there's a good scientific motivation for building them. It's not, in other words, it's not a quick thing to fund or get built.
So when do you get to take it home? When you get paid $2 billion for...
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, next question from Daniel Breach. Over what time span were these images taken? The planets around HR 8799.
So the length of time of that video was something like an hour. And we took that image back in, I think it was around 2010. Sorry, I'm not sure.
I think that answers the question. All right, next one from JP. That star with the four planets, what period were those orbits?
So very long. So there, I think we were looking at separations that were about 12, 20, 40, and 70 AU, or 70 times the distance of the Earth is from our own sun. So, you know, they, Becky might show a little bit more about it, but we haven't tracked a complete orbit yet for these objects. We've seen orbital motion of these objects just by following them since they were actually first detected in around 2006, if I have that right.
How close can you usually get to a star? Like, how many AU?
Yeah, it's actually one of the limitations that we're constantly trying to improve. So for that one, you know, you could see that inner planet at about 12 AU was, you know, nearing our limit. So typically getting in closer than about 10 AU is really difficult. It can be done, but it's that's where the state of the art challenge is.
All right, and looks like one more question. How far away was the star system you showed with the four Jupiter-like planets?
Let's see. It must have been about, it's about 40 parsecs. So about 100, just over 100 light years. It's not a particularly nearby star. I think what that's telling us is that system with that a lot of, you know, massive planets is not particularly common. But it's the ones we can see as well, since the more massive planets are the ones that are a bit brighter, so that we can find them.
Right. What would be a more sort of usual makeup of like planet sort of characteristics or planet types?
Well, I mean, I think we see that the number of stars with planets above a Jupiter or above several Jupiter is very small, less than 1 in 100 or something like that, if I'm remembering my numbers right. And yet, you know, with Kepler and other observatories, we see that planets less massive are a lot more common. So I think that's sort of reflecting what the early days of being able to image planets.
Another question just came in. Do you have to consider that the resolution of your final image may be limited by the number of actuators? If you have 10 actuators, you have a grid of 10 images.
So if you don't have as many actuators as you would like, it doesn't hurt your resolution as much as it limits how faint you can see, because you can't correct that wavefront at quite the precision you could if you had more actuators. So that's the sort of trade-off that we try and make, or you know, convince ourselves that here's why we need so many actuators, is because we need to see so to a certain level below the stellar flux. And that's not a simple, I'm sort of simplifying a pretty difficult calculation that depends on a lot of things.
Wow. Well, thank you. These are some really great
great questions from the audience, really great answers from you. So really appreciate you taking some time from your evening to speak with us.
Thank you, I enjoyed it.
Yeah, well, we hope that we can host you again. We hope this isn't your first and last, but first of many. All right, so now I think we'll do some trivia for the audience. So I think there is a link to a Google form that you all can fill out to submit your answers to these questions. If you want to be old school, you know, you can write on a piece of paper and mail it to me. Maybe not to me, to somebody. Mail it to Kamala. She'll care. Just kidding, I care. So let's get started. February trivia. Let me share my screen. And we'll get to it. So, first we'll start off with some questions on seasonal astronomy. All right, number one. Which planet is the only one visible with our naked eye in the February night sky? Which planet is the only one visible with our naked eye in the February night sky? Okay. Enough time to lock in your answers. Let's go to the next one. Number two, February 15th. On this day in 1564, the Italian discoverer of Jupiter's moons was born. What was his name? February 15th, on this day in 1564, the Italian discoverer of Jupiter's moons was born. What was his name? Okay. I hope to have a picture of me painted like that one day. One day. Okay, now on to the topic of the evening, photographing faraway worlds. Number three, bitumen of Judea, asphalt, and oil of lavender were used in the coating and washing of the first photograph. What century did this occur? Wow. Bitumen of Judea, or asphalt, and oil of lavender were used in the coating and washing of the first photograph. What century did this occur? I believe in you all. I think you're gonna all get 100%. All right, let's try the next one. The first publicly available photographic processing improvements were introduced by Daguerre. What toxic metal was used to develop the silver plate photograph? A, mercury, B, lead, C, bismuth, or D, carbon? What toxic metal was used to develop the silver plate photograph? Was it A, mercury, B, lead, C, bismuth, or D, carbon? All right, number five. Astrophotography began with Daguerre. What was the first astronomical object photographed? Is that it right there? A, the sun, B, Jupiter, C, the moon, or D, Venus? What was the first astronomical object photographed? A, the sun, B, Jupiter, C, the moon, or D, Venus? All right, jumping to the next one. What was the first photographed star? Hint, we haven't made contact. Again, what was the first photographed star? Hint, we have not made contact. All right, next one. Okay, now to the 21st century. The below movie shows the orbits of the most famously photographed planetary system. 2 points if you can name that system. Wow, 2 points. Okay, now to the 21st century. The below movie shows the orbits of the most famously photographed planetary system. 2 points if you can name that system. You know, somebody should submit my name so I can be the new host of Jeopardy. I think I can do it. I think I can make Alex proud. You know, another Alex? Come on. All right, next one. Number 8. The topic of this AOT is adaptive optics. What do these tiny mirrors correct for to allow moves like the one you just saw and the one below? I think it's movies. The topic of this AOT is adaptive optics. What do these tiny mirrors correct for to allow movies like the one you just saw and the one below? Is it A, space junk, B, interstellar medium, C, dark matter, or D, Earth's atmosphere? Again, that was A, space junk. What is being corrected for? A, space junk, B, interstellar medium, C, dark matter, or D, Earth's atmosphere. Wow, very cool. And then the answers. Okay, well, stay tuned. I'll give out the answers at the end of the show. All right, we've got one more speaker and then we can know who to shower with praise. So I'll give one more thanks to Phil Hinz, our first speaker. And now let's hear from our second speaker, Becky Jensen Clem. Hello, welcome.
Hi, thank you, Alex.
Thanks for joining us. Have you done an AOT before?
I have never spoken at an AOT, but I did attend one back in Seattle quite some years ago. So I'm happy to be speaking at one now.
Nice. Well, happy to have you.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to be giving the second part of this talk on photographing faraway worlds. Phil gave some insight into how he got interested in this topic. For me, I got interested in astronomy in general as a kid. My dad had a little backyard telescope that we used to use together. And from that time on, I was really fascinated with telescopes in general and how we can push them to their very limits of performance. And that's really what adaptive optics is all about, is pushing the limits of telescopes to have them work as well as they possibly can. Okay, so when it comes to photographing faraway worlds, I wanted to first think about an image that you might have seen with your own eyes before. So if you went and stood outside on a large field, like one of the meadows on the UCSC campus, and if you happen to go outside on a night when several different planets are visible, like in this image here, you would see the planets as these bright points of light. Here, this image shows Venus, Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter. So if you're a scientist and you want to study these planets, what are some of the observations available to you? Well, you can have a very large telescope and you could point that at one of these planets. So this is an image of Jupiter taken with a very large telescope that allows us to see very fine details on Jupiter. So unlike when you look at Jupiter with your eyes and you just see this kind of uniform spot, with a telescope, you can see all of these fine features like the cloud bands and the great red spot on Jupiter. Okay, now astronomers have also been able to take these observations a step further. You can launch a satellite or a probe from the Earth, and you can send that satellite to visit one of the planets in our solar system. So this is a picture of Saturn from orbit around Saturn. This was taken by the Cassini spacecraft, which orbited Saturn for 13 years up until, I believe, 2017, so just recently. And so if you send a spacecraft to orbit another planet, that allows you to study that planet up close and personal for a long period of time. And so you can form these kinds of amazing images where you, here you see this fantastic detail in the rings of Saturn that would have been impossible from Earth. Okay, let's take this another step further. What if you don't just want to orbit that planet with a satellite? What if you want to send a rover to that planet? And this is an image taken by NASA's Opportunity rover in 2007 from the surface of Mars. So here we're seeing the surface of Mars and the tracks left in the Martian dust by the Opportunity rover, just as if this were a photo taken on a desert in California. So this is some of the amazing precision measurements that we can make on the planets in our solar system by visiting them. And there are rovers currently on Mars that have even more advanced capabilities, such as drilling into the rocks and taking samples of materials on Mars. But of course, what we would all love to do is to be able to visit these other planets in person. And humans haven't visited any other planet in our solar system aside from Earth. But of course, we have visited the moon. And this is an image from the Apollo 11 mission to the moon in 1969. So we go from looking at the sky with our eyes to training telescopes on it, to sending satellites to orbit other planets, to potentially launching rovers or potentially sending people. So these are some of the ways that we study the astronomical bodies in our solar system. But when you want to study a planet that orbits another star other than the sun, you have a whole other set of challenges. So the first challenge is that planets are a whole lot fainter than stars. So for instance, a star like our sun is about a billion times brighter than the light that it would reflect from its planets. So if you wanted to see the Earth orbiting a star like the sun, you would have to be able to see something a billion times fainter than that sun. The other point, which is even more difficult for astronomers to overcome, is that the stars are so incredibly far away from us. So the nearest star to the sun, or the nearest star to the Earth, is 25 trillion miles away. So we're trying to see something very faint, a planet, that's very close to something that's very far away. And why is that distance such a problem? I want to explain this by making an analogy with car headlights. So if you have a car that's right up in front of you, you can easily distinguish the two headlights from each other. You can see these well-separated points of light. But now imagine that the car is way, way down the road. It's way far away from you. So then the headlights appear to you as if they're much closer together, right? I mean, of course, we know that the headlights have the same actual separation on the car, but to your eyes, when that car is very far away, those headlights appear closer together. And if the car was very, very far away, eventually your eyes couldn't distinguish those two headlights. They would just look like a single headlight. So this gets at the reason why it's so hard to directly take a picture of a planet. The situation is like you have a set of headlights from a car, but that car is trillions of miles away from you, and one headlight is a billion times brighter than the other. So those are some of the reasons why it's taken astronomers quite a bit longer to directly image other planets compared to discovering exoplanets using these more indirect means. So Phil mentioned that the very first exoplanet was discovered indirectly in about 1995. It took another 10, or a little more than 10 years for astronomers to be able to take a picture of the very first exoplanet. So it's because of this issue of resolving very fine features. So resolving, you know, the headlights of a car that are very far away. This is why we need such extremely large telescopes in astronomy. So this is a picture of the Keck Observatory It's a 10 meter wide mirror that we use to collect our starlight. So you can see a picture of this mirror here. If you have sharp eyes and if you have a good picture, you can tell that this is actually made out of several segments. These are segments of the mirror in the shape of a hexagon. And we do that because if we were to try to make the mirror out of just one enormous piece of material, it would be very heavy and unwieldy, and it would be prone to deforming under its own gravity. So instead, we often make these large telescope mirrors in segments to make each one lighter and easier to work with. So with a large telescope, you can collect more light than your eyes, for instance. That allows you to see objects in the night sky that are much fainter than your eyes can see. But as Phil was explaining, if you have a larger telescope, that means that you can resolve finer details. So if we go back to this headlight analogy, for a very distant car, a small telescope may not be able to distinguish the two headlights from each other, but a large telescope like Keck would be able to distinguish those fine features. So if you want to see something very faint, that is right next to something that's very bright, you need a large telescope for those two reasons. Okay, but as Phil was explaining, we have a big problem when these telescopes, as large telescopes are located here on Earth. And that's because the light from these astronomical objects has to travel through the Earth's atmosphere where they get distorted and blurred. And so Phil told you all about how adaptive optic systems work. And they allow telescopes like Keck Observatory that I just showed to act or to perform almost, not quite, but almost as if they were above the Earth's atmosphere in space. Okay, so with a very high quality adaptive optics system, you could potentially form a very sharp image of the star. So in this diagram, imagine for a moment that you have the starlight that's coming in from your large telescope mirror. So imagine your large telescope mirror is way off to the left on this photo. And then you get yourself a series of mirrors and lenses, and you use those to focus that starlight onto your camera. And so you take a picture of the star, you use your state-of-the-art adaptive optics system, and you might form an image of that star that looks something like this, what you see in this right-hand image here. Now, you might be thinking, well, that's not a very sharp point. It's the star still has some width, but that's not because of the blurring of the Earth's atmosphere. This is actually due to fundamental properties of light. So when light bends around our different optics, as we create an image with that light, it interferes with itself. This is a process called diffraction. And that means that when you take a picture of the star, it never appears to you as an infinitely tiny point. It always does have some width to it. So that's why the star looks the way it does in this image. But there's kind of a problem here. I mean, even if we formed as sharp an image of the star as physics allows us to do, what if you had a very faint planet that was located on one of these bright, what we call diffraction rings around the star? Well, then you still may not be able to see that planet. It might be too faint for you to see compared to these features of the star. So to block out the light from the star, we have a few different options. So Phil explained to us one of the options that involves watching as the star is rising and setting, and as the planet would just appear on the sky to be rotating. That's one way that we use to help distinguish the planet from other artifacts in our image. But we have additional tricks up our sleeve, and I want to explain to you what one of those is. So we can put in some special pieces of hardware into this sequence of lenses and mirrors that we're using to form an image of the star that will help us cancel out the light from the star so that we can see a planet right next to it. So I'm going to give you an example of a two-component system for canceling out the starlight. Okay, so the first component here is what we call a coronagraph mask. And you stick that into the light just as you're bringing it to a focus. And what the coronagraph mask does is it has, for example, a little dot, let's say it's a little black dot in the center of, say, a see-through piece of glass. And you put that right where you're bringing the starlight to a focus. So what that'll do is it'll block out most of that starlight. What it also does, this is a little bit counterintuitive, but what it also does is it throws a lot of the remaining light out to the edges of the image. And that's where the second component of our coronagraph comes in. We take a piece of hardware that's kind of like a glorified washer that you would buy at the hardware store, just like a little ring of material. We call this a Leo mask. It's named after one of the first astronomers to use this kind of device, whose last name was Leo. So we put that in to block out that light that the coronagraph throw out to the edges of the image. And with those two optics, we've blocked out most of the light from the star. But what happens to the light from the planet? So the planet is located just a little bit off center from the star, right? So in that case, as the planet's light propagates through this system, it would just barely miss this black dot that you put in to get rid of the light from the star. So it misses that black dot, and it misses the part that the washer is blocking out as well. It propagates through that and less disturbed. So this allows the planet light to move through the system without being disturbed, but it cancels out most of that starlight. So the end result is something like the picture that you're seeing in the right-hand side here. You've created this dark zone where you've gotten rid of most of the light from the star, and you're allowing the light from a planet to shine through so that you can actually see it. So in order to image other planets, we have probably four components to this puzzle. The first one is adaptive optics. So we tame the distortions from the atmosphere. The second one is this coronagraph system for canceling out the light from the star. The third one is these different observational techniques, like what Phil explained about watching the system as it progresses through the sky at night. And then the fourth one is, how do we use our computers to take a look at this data after we've collected it from the telescope and do the best job we can at subtracting out any remaining residual starlight that's blocking our view from the star. And when we put those four elements together, we can form these beautiful pictures of other planets. So this is one that Alex just showed you as part of the trivia. And Phil also showed it to you in a different form. This is the famous, or famous to astronomers at least, HR8799 four planet system. And what you're seeing here is a sequence of images, not taken over a single night. So this is different than what Phil was showing. This is a sequence of images taken over the course of years. So if you see the date marker in the lower left-hand side, it starts in 2009. And it goes all the way up to 2015. So we're watching from taking images many times over the course of those years, we're watching the progression of the orbits of those planets. So somebody asked previously, how long are the orbits of these planets? Well, you can tell if this sequence of images where we just see this kind of modest amount of motion around the star over this period of time, these are many, many year long orbits. So we will not live to see complete orbits of these planets. Okay, so at this point, I want to answer the question of what do we learn by taking pictures of these planets? So we go to great lengths, we go to great expense in order to take these pictures. So what are we learning about the planets from doing so? Well, we learn a few things. First of all, by taking a picture of a planet and measuring how bright it is in different wavelengths of light, you can tell something about that planet's temperature. And to explain why this is, on the right-hand side here, I'm showing a picture of a nail that's being heated by a blowtorch. So you see the blowtorch here and the heated nail. So the hottest parts of the nail are glowing at different colors than the colder parts. So the hottest part of the nail is glowing yellow. Getting cooler, it's glowing orange, red, deep red, and then when it's completely cold, it's back to black again. So This is a way of understanding that if you can see the color of an object or how much light it's emitting at what wavelength of light, you can measure its temperature. So by taking pictures of a planet, we can measure its temperature. We can also measure the planet's size. In physics and astrophysics, we draw a distinction between two quantities for a planet's size. On Earth, you know, often we talk about our weight. That's a measure of how hard gravity is pulling on us. But in physics, we also talk about mass. And that's a different quantity that refers to how much stuff is in an object. So your mass is the same no matter where you are, but your weight changes depending on the force of gravity where you are. That's why astronauts appear to be sort of hopping around in this funny way on the moon. If you see video footage of astronauts on the moon is much smaller. And so your weight is lower on the moon, but of course your mass is the same. Anyway, so the way that we can measure a planet's mass by taking a picture of it is we can first know something of the planet's age. And we do that by measurements of the star. And I can talk more about that if anyone's interested after the fact. But we study the star in detail. We assume that the planet and the star are about the same age. So we know something of this planet's age. Then we think to ourselves, well, planets, when they form, they're quite hot initially, and then they cool down over time. So if you know a planet's age and you know how bright it is, you can extrapolate to how massive it is. So a more massive planet will take longer to cool down than a less massive planet. Okay, now the third thing that we learn when we take pictures of exoplanets is probably one of the most important reasons why we directly image exoplanets. And that is that this is a way that we can learn what a planet's atmosphere is made out of. And how do we do this? Well, hopefully at one point or another, all of you have had a chance to play with a prism, maybe in a science class, or at a science fair or museum. So when you send white light or sunlight through a prism, you're dividing that light up into different colors. Now, you can't see this with a prism because it's not dividing the light up very far, but if you had a super prism that could divide the sunlight very, very finely into different colors, you would see something a little bit surprising. At certain points, at some very specific colors, there's some light that's missing from the sun. And that's because there are some materials in the sun, different atoms and molecules that absorb light at particular wavelengths. And so there's an absence of light at those particular wavelengths. And some astronomers could take one look at that picture and reel off what the sun is made out of just by looking at what we call these absorption lines, or these areas of missing light. So we can do something similar for exoplanets. If you've taken a picture of an exoplanet, if you've isolated that light from its star, you can also spread that light out by wavelength. You can look at the wavelengths where light is missing, and you can learn something about what's in that planet's atmosphere. Now, if you were to do this kind of process for the Earth, one thing among many things that you would see is evidence of our ozone layer. So ozone is a molecule made out of three oxygen atoms stuck together. And the reason we have an ozone layer is because the oxygen in our atmosphere is being constantly replenished by plants. So as plants photosynthesize, as they get energy from sunlight, they also release oxygen as a byproduct. So if you were to look at another planet and see these fingerprints of ozone, that would give you a pretty strong idea that there's something exciting going on that planet, and maybe something like photosynthesis. Okay. But in this picture that I showed earlier, and in the pictures that Phil showed, this image is not perfect. So you see this planet, but you also see this kind of scattered bits of light that you haven't quite succeeded in getting rid of from the star. And there are a few reasons for that. One is that your adaptive optics has some limitations to how well it's performing. But the other is that you might have some imperfections in these lenses and mirrors that you're using to focus the light from the star and the planet. What if, you know, you had a thumbprint on one of those mirrors, for instance, or what if there was a scratch or a little air bubble, or the mirror that you wanted to be flat wasn't perfectly flat? These are all reasons why you might have some of these little extra bits of starlight that you didn't intend to have. So the issue of adaptive optics performance can be got around by moving into space. You could put a telescope above the Earth's atmosphere. This is a picture of the Hubble Space Telescope. And that would help you to not have to use adaptive optics anymore. You would be above the Earth's atmosphere. So that's no longer an issue. But you still have those little imperfections in your optics that can still lead to these areas in the image that are prohibiting you from knowing whether or not a planet is there. So I want to leave you with a really fascinating way that astronomers are trying to get around that issue. And this is something, a device that we call the star shade. So the idea is that instead of using this set of coronagraph hardware inside the telescope, so instead of that little dot and the washer, what if instead we made this giant flower-shaped device and we flew it outside of our telescope and we flew it in front of the star? So I should be clear, we're not sending this object all the way to the star. This is just a few kilometers or tens of kilometers from the spacecraft. But this is acting as if your eye was the telescope and your thumb was the star shade. And what if you stretched out your thumb and you put it in front of a star or like a street lamp, say, so that you could see something faint next to it? That's how the star shade is behaving. It means that the starlight that the coronagraph is usually trying to block out never makes it to your telescope in the first place. So if you have those little imperfections in your lenses and mirrors, it's not as big a deal because you have much less starlight scattering off of them in the first place. So what's challenging about the star shade, there are many things that are challenging about the star shade, as you can probably imagine, is that the edges of this flower petal shape have to be extremely sharp. If they have some thickness to them, it makes it too easy for light to glint off the edges and cause other problems for you. So the edges have to be exceedingly sharp and also a very dark color to prevent unwanted reflections. So this is basically a giant ninja throwing star in space. Okay, so that's a proposed concept that astronomers would like to see happen in the future as an alternative to this coronagraph technology. So I'm gonna leave you with this amazing gallery of videos. The one on the left you've seen before, this is HR-799. This gallery of images in the middle shows a planet. I think this was the third exoplanet ever directly imaged. It's called Beta Pictoris B. And between 2013 and 2019, you see Beta Pic B actually go very close to going in front of its star, and then it reemerges on the other side. So we just happen to see the orbit, not quite edge on, but close to edge on. And then on the right-hand side, this is the smallest, the lowest mass exoplanet ever directly imaged. It's named 51 Airy B, and you see it trace out a little bit of its orbit there. And all of these sequences of images were taken with one of the most advanced adaptive optics and coronagraph systems ever made on a system called the Gemini Planet Imager that's located at the Gemini South Telescope down in Chile. So with that, I'll leave you with these images and I'm happy to take any questions.
Round of applause.
Thank you, Alex.
Yeah, thank you. That was a really, really interesting, really cool talk. Let's see if we've got any questions that have come in over the past few minutes. Okay. Doesn't look like there have been any questions from the YouTube yet.
Alex, what's your favorite exoplanet?
Oh, geez. Well, I just started watching this show called Raised by Wolves. And they reference like Kepler 22b, I think, in it. Like this is the planet that they go to in order to like rebuild human civilization and stuff. So honestly, that's the only even like vague reference to an exoplanet as like sort of specific one that I can think of. I do like you have it. A favorite?
Well, I think any astronomer who works on the direct imaging of exoplanets has a soft spot for HR8799B. Okay. It's one of the few directly imaged planets where you can see more than one planet in the system. So that's pretty special.
Yeah, that is very, very cool. Very special. Yeah. Well, let's see if anything. Oh, they're prompting the audience to see. You just gave such a clear and nice talk that
everything is 100% clear. There's crystal, no confusion whatsoever.
Crystal clear. Let me see if I've got any questions for you. Yeah, I can't really think of any either. Oh, here's one. How fast do the adaptive optics need to respond?
Yeah, so in an ideal world, they would respond infinitely fast, but of course we can't do that. In reality, most adaptive optic systems run about 1,000 times per second. The fastest ones can go 2 or even 3,000 times per second, but the problem is that you need to be able to know what shape to give your deformable mirror. And to know what shape to give your deformable mirror, you have to collect a little bit of starlight so you can measure the shape of the atmospheric turbulence. And if you cut that time too short for measuring the shape of the wavefront, you're just not going to measure it very well. So your performance starts to degrade. So that's one of the limitations on speed. Something that my group works on at UC Santa Cruz is saying, well, we need a little bit of that time to measure the shape of the wavefront. But of course, that means that we can't run as fast as we like to. So why don't we try to use our previous measurements of atmospheric turbulence to predict what the next shape will be? So that's something that we call predictive wavefront control, or that's another way of saying predictive adaptive optics. So that's a way we're working on trying to fix that kind of problem.
Wow, nice. Oh, okay. A few more have come in. A question from Daniel Breach. Would the star shade have to be specific to a single star if it is situated so far from the telescope?
So you don't have to have one star shade per star, but your question does get at a difficulty with the star shade, which is that if it's located, you know, tens of kilometers from the telescope, it's going to take you a long time to move that star shade over to a, you know, to block out the light from a different star. And that's true. That is a serious limitation of this technique. So what astronomers have been proposing is you wouldn't always be using the star shade. You would put it in position, you would take your observations with the star shade, and then while you were moving the star shade somewhere else, you would do other, you know, normal kinds of astrophysics observations that didn't require that. So that's a good question.
We've got a question from Phil Hins. When will we see our first rocky planet?
Ooh, that's a good question, Phil. yeah, so right now, these planets that I've showed you, these are super Jupiter-sized planets. And these are really quite different than the planets that we have in our solar system, and especially different from rocky planets like Earth or Mars or Venus. So that's something that we're working very hard to do, is being able to observe planets that are as faint as rocky planets might be. So our first opportunity for actually taking a picture of a rocky planet is probably going to be somewhere in the next 10 to 15 years when we have that new class of large telescopes. For the first time, those telescopes can collect enough light and they can separate the planet and the star enough for us to potentially make those measurements. But even with those new telescopes that are, say, 30 or 40 meters in diameter compared to our current 8 to 10 meter diameter telescopes, even with those, it's going to be very challenging. And we're going to need to throw every trick in the book, all of our adaptive optics, our fanciest deformable mirrors, our fanciest coronagraphs, to actually accomplish that. So that's something that Phil and I and many people all over the world are trying hard to do.
Nice. The next question from D. Dutton. The flowers at the edge of the space device, are they shaped that way to apodize?
Oh, yes. You're using a good buzzword there. Yes. yeah. So the question of why we have this particular shape on the starshade, this also has to do with this concept of diffraction. So if the starshade just had a simple circular shape, the light from the star would be, you know, bending around that circle in a particular way. And if we want to suppress as much of that light as possible, it helps to give it these petal shapes. So this is all about that diffraction effect.
Wow, nice. Okay, a question from Tony Sloss. Do all the orbiting bodies around a central body always orbit in the same direction?
Oh, that's a good question. So most of the time they do. And the reason is that when a planetary system is forming, both the planets and the star were originally, before they formed, all of that material was part of an interstellar cloud of gas and dust. And that cloud would have been rotating ever so slowly, and then eventually it started to collapse under its own gravity. And due to something called the conservation of angular momentum, as it collapsed, it started spinning faster and faster. So this is like an ice skater who starts spinning, and then as they pull in their arms, they rotate faster and faster. It's the exact same thing. And so eventually the star, as it forms, it will itself be rotating in a particular way. Our sun is rotating. And then the planets as they form will be rotating around the star also in that same direction. And that's all because of the way that initial nebula was rotating. But we can't rule out there are effects like collisions. There can be gravitational interactions between planets or between the star and the planet that could kick it into a crazy orbit. Mm-hmm. But most of the time, the planets are rotating in the same way around the star.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Next question from Tom Dayton. Is it correct that the adaptive optics must predict the distortions that are about to arise?
When I was mentioning the prediction earlier, this is something that's really on the cutting edge of research that we're trying to do. The normal adaptive optics systems don't predict what the future shape will be. They measure what the shape is, and then they apply it to the deformable mirror. And so they know that, okay, I know the atmosphere will have changed a little bit by the time I make that correction, but that's okay, that's a small effect. When this becomes important is in these extreme AO cases, when we're trying to see these very faint planets. And that's when we start thinking, okay, we can improve this performance by doing this prediction. So right now, this kind of prediction, adaptive optics, is only being done at a few observatories around the world. And we're trying to do that at Keck as well. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Next question from John Pierce. Oh, I said, that was my question. That starshade would take so long to line up with a new project. It would not be very practical.
It doesn't take so long if you schedule your observations correctly. You know, you wouldn't want to have it on one side of the telescope and then have to move all the way over to the other and back and forth. You can be efficient. You could say, I've got a plan where I'm going to observe these stars, that I'm going to, you know, arrange my observations in a row so that I can go from star to star to star. So it's certainly a drawback, but it's by no means a showstopper for this kind of approach.
Hmm. Good to know. A question from Jules Fowler. Feel free to ignore me.
We want to know you, Jules.
I could ask later. We will not ignore Jules. I feel like I remember something about how star shade edges have subtly weird shapes. Oh, okay. So you kind of touched on this one already. The kind of like an appetizer in reverse.
Yes. So they do have these kind of funny shapes that are all about trying to do this starlight suppression all kind of in one shot. And the question about appetization gets into some technical detail, but all of these aspects, the starshade, what we call an appetized kind of coronagraph, all of these are different ways of solving the same problem, which is suppressing that starlight.
And wow, so many questions. Oh my goodness, so many. Okay. I guess we can just say that we'll stop in like 2 minutes so that we won't hold you on here forever answering questions, but some really great questions coming in. Another one from Robert Kohlenberger. Any way to detect exoplanetary rotation or detect moons?
Oh, yeah, good questions. So for rotation, yes. If you were to monitor the brightness of a planet very carefully, and if that planet had, say, banded clouds like Jupiter has, like go back to that image of Jupiter, or if they had something to induce some kind of brightness differences on the planet, if you could monitor its brightness over time, you would see that brightness change. So you would form what we call a light curve, a plot of the planet's brightness versus time. And just like we do for stars, you could measure a planet's rotation period this way. So this is also something that's very hard to do because monitoring the brightness of these planets requires very stable measurements over time for you to be really sure that you're seeing a change in the planet itself and not a change in your equipment, but we can. Another way to measure a planet's rotation is by taking a very precise spectrum of that planet. And you can look at, when you spread the light out versus wavelength, you can look at some of the details, like for instance, some of these absorption features, so these areas of missing starlight, the shape of those features changes depending on how fast the planet is rotating. And so this technique has been used to measure the rotation rates of actually quite a few exoplanets at this point. There's a second part of that question.
About detecting moons,
yes. So this is something that that folks have been trying to do, some using data from the Kepler Space Telescope, which detects planets indirectly by watching the stars get fainter when a planet passes in front of that star. And they've looked for extra little dips in the star's brightness due to moons. There have been a few kind of claims here and there, but this is still a very developing field. So I think we're not quite ready to definitively say we've detected these things, but many people are trying, and I think it's just a matter of time before we can do that.
All right, another one from Hema Sinibaldi. How did you get the name of the coronagraph mask?
Oh, that Leo. Well, actually, okay, there are two types. There's the name coronagraph, and then there's the name Leo mask. So, and those are interlinked. So the name coronagraph comes from when astronomers were trying to take pictures of the sun's corona. So these are the very outermost layers of the sun. If you got to see the 2017 solar eclipse, or if you saw photos that were taken during the solar eclipse, you would have seen this extended light around the sun's disk called the corona. So originally, a coronagraph was an instrument made to block out the light from the sun artificially, so you didn't have to wait for an eclipse that would allow you to see that corona. And an astronomer named Bernard Leo was one such person who built these devices. And he also had a second element, the washer-shaped device, which we now call the Leo mask or the Leo stop. So that's where those names come from.
Oh, some nice history. Another one from Janet Parkins. Could you talk a little bit more about why the light from the central star gets distributed to the edge of the image?
Oh, yeah. So this one, it's always hard to explain because most of us don't have an intuition for the particular type of math that's needed to demonstrate why this is. So when you go between these two areas in this optical setup, one is where you've brought the light to a focus. That's where we put the coronagraph mask. And the other is where we've made the light rays parallel again. When you go between that focal area to where the light rays are parallel, there's a certain mathematical relationship between those two areas. And that mathematical relationship helps us understand why some of that excess light gets out towards the edges.
Okay. All right. Another one from, I think we've only got three more, so I think we can make it through the rest. from Carolee, how does a scientific team decide where to target these star shades?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that question gets at how do we pick any star to search for planets around that star using direct imaging? So right now, all of these planets that we have imaged so far, not just the ones that I showed in this talk, but all of the planets that we've directly imaged, they tend to be orbiting extremely young stars. And that helps us see them because the planets are glowing hot when they're young. So they're easier for us to see. They're also around stars that are very close to the Earth. And so just like the headlight analogy that I gave, if something is very far away, it's harder to distinguish the planet from the star. So it's easy for us to find planets when the star is very close to us so that the planet looks like it's a bit farther away from the star. So the first surveys where astronomers went out and looked around many stars for planets, they said, okay, what are the stars that are the closest to the Earth and the ones that are youngest? And they went there first. So now we're expanding that list a little bit. We're trying to say, well, maybe we can combine the information that we have with indirect means of discovering planets with direct imaging. So for example, there's a satellite in space right now called Gaia, and Gaia is monitoring the positions of billions of stars with extreme precision. And as a planet orbits the star does not only pull on the planet with its gravity, but the planet also pulls on the star with its gravity. And so if you could trace out a star's path across the sky, if it has a planet, it won't just be a straight line, rather it'll be kind of a loop-de-loop if you could watch it for long enough. And so now we're starting to think, okay, if we see the strange pattern with the Gaia Space Telescope, that's probably a good star for us to follow up with direct imaging or with another technique. So that's kind of where we're moving these days.
Wow, that's really cool. Wow. Okay. One more from Daniel Breach. Does the edge of the coronagraph mask have a specific shape? Okay. To account for diffraction similar to the star shade, or does the LEO washer account for this?
Yeah. So you have a bunch of options. You have a lot of options for the shape to make your coronagraph mask. The simplest possible one would to just be a simple circular dot. The next most complex one would be you could have the edges sort of fade out gradually in a particular way. And then it gets even more complicated from there. There are people who do their whole PhDs on what crazy pattern could we put on our coronagraph mask to do the best job we possibly could. So it doesn't look just like the star shade because of the different optical configuration involved, but it has a whole suite of options that you could put on there.
And then last question from Julia Bravo. How expensive would the star shade be?
It would be very expensive. That is absolutely true. I'm trying to remember if I have any numbers in my mind. I don't have any exact numbers, but if you go on Google and if you search NASA star shade, you'll find a ton of information about that. NASA has actually been studying this concept for quite a few years now. And they've been projecting things like cost and how long it would take to build and how long it would take to move the star shade from star to star in order to say, is this something we should do in the future? So so these questions are ones that people are actively exploring.
Nice. Well, that was the last question that we had. Thanks to our audience for sending in some really great questions. And thank you, Becky, for being such a wonderful speaker and teaching us all so much this evening.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, I hope to have you again.
Thank you. I hope to come back too.
All right. Well, from here, I think we'll go over the questions for the quiz, or I'll reveal the answers to you and then name our, I guess, winners or the highest scoring quizzes. Here we are. Okay. So the answers for the seasonal astronomy portion. Number one, this planet is the only one visible with our naked eye in the February night sky, and that is Mars. This is a picture of Mars. All right, and number two, February 15th, on this day in 1564, the Italian discoverer of Jupiter's moons was born. What was his name? That was Galileo. I'm speeding through, okay? And then on to the topic, photographing faraway worlds. This one, bitumen of Judea, asphalt, and oil of lavender were used in the coating and washing of the first photographs. what century did this occur? The answer was B, the 19th century. Got it. All right. Number four. The first publicly available photographic processing improvements were introduced by Daguerre. What toxic metal was used to develop the silver plate photograph? And that is A, mercury. Next one. Astrophotography began with Daguerre. What was the first astronomical object photographed? That's C, the moon. And I believe that is the moon right there. All right, number six. What was the first photographed star? Hint, we haven't made contact. That is Vega. All right, next up. Now to the 21st century. The below movie shows the orbits of the most famously photographed planetary system. 2 points if you can name that system. That was HR 8799. A favorite of the evening. All right, and number eight. The topic of this AOT is adaptive optics. What do these tiny mirrors correct for to allow movies like the one you just saw and the one below? And that was D, the Earth's atmosphere. And that's it. Answers to all of our questions. And as for our winners, let me look and see what has been reported. Okay, John Pierce got an 8 out of 9. Nice. That's our winner. And then a three-way tie for second with John, Heidi, and Mike. So, yes. Uh-oh. There are a lot of notes that I'm reading. Tiebreaker goes to John and Micah for saying first photograph star is the sun, which is technically correct. And John said this also. So 7 out of 9. Okay. Yes, and then I think some people were also saying that the solar system was the most imaged planetary system, which, like, okay, yeah. But that does make sense. So good job to all of you. We appreciate your attendance with us this evening and your participation and the wonderful questions you all are asking. Although, you know, this is done over a distance right now, it's really fun still being able to engage with everyone this way and see how excited people are getting, you know, about research and these sorts of topics. It's really cool to see. So thank you again so much for coming out this evening. Congrats again to the high scorers on our quiz, and we hope to see you again next month. Let me check and see if we know what the theme is for that one and who our speakers are. I can't find it, so I'm just going to leave it be. But we'll make announcements. We'll, you know, post on social media. So make sure you're following us on Twitter. Subscribe to the YouTube channel. And we've also got a website up now at, I think it's aot.ucsc.edu. So that's really cool. So yeah, thanks again for coming out tonight. And we will see you next time. And thanks again to our speakers, Becky and Phil. It was really awesome having you here. All right. Good night.